Hello everyone, I think we are now live. So I was actually I chose the background in my background by thinking of Fabio's talk today, but I kind of had a spoiler a few seconds ago when I saw it first, right? But probably not all of you have seen it. Anyway, I don't know if you've read Fabio's title, like his talk. The talk of his title is "It's Too Acidic." It is great to me. That's why I chose this background where did a small kid enjoying a lemon. Anyway, so Fabio's talk reminded me of some people who had enjoyed acid. I mean, Fabio's going to talk about a journey he had with acid. So I kind of tried to do the same humor he did. And I kind of look, he's going to talk about catalysis. So I wanted to see, to talk about the catalytic cycle Fabio had in his acidic journey. So Fabio was born a few years ago, in 84, in Narni. So before actually knowing Fabio, I didn't know that Narnia actually existed. So when people talk about the Chronicles of Narnia, actually where Fabio was born. And it's not too far away from L'Aquila, it's in near Terni, in Umbria. So from there, Fabio moved to Bologna to study industrial chemistry. So he did his bachelor and master in industrial chemistry in Bologna, and his PhD with Professor Paolo Melchiorre in organocatalysis. So Paolo Melchiorre at that time was actually in the rising the ladder of academic career, and now he's one of the top leaders in organocatalysis in the world. During his stay there, Fabio also went to Germany for a short stay with like 8 months with Magnus Rupping. For his postdoc, he came back to Germany in another group, the group of Professor Benjamin List, and he's another world-renowned leader in organocatalysis. For people who are actually very familiar with organocatalysis, will actually, these names will recall, will remind them a lot. So Paolo worked in organocatalysis with Melchiorre, Rupping, and Benjamin List. For a postdoc with me. He came back for a short stay in Pavia with Professor Zanoni, working on metal and organocatalysis. And then he came back to Germany to work on metal catalysis with on TH activation, one of the research, the frontier research of nowadays, to work with Professor Lutz Ackermann in Göttingen. So as you can see, like Fabio actually spent a lot of years in Germany. And I was kind of like scared he was going to present today in German, but I asked him, and he actually reassured me it's going to be a talk in English. So actually, I can actually enjoy it because I cannot actually speak German that fluently. I cannot speak for German at all. So but anyway, after like his stay in his third postdoc with Lutz Ackermann in Germany, Fabio joined us in L'Aquila, so that's his catalytic cycle is back here, near his hometown, let's say a couple of hours away from his hometown. So Fabio joined last year, July 2020, as a fixed term researcher, so RTDA, that A for people who know the Italian system. And so why cycle is closing here now? Because basically he is, again, close to his hometown, but he's also working with his one of his supervisors during his master's thesis, and that's me, actually. So I was actually supervising his master's thesis, and it's a coincidence, actually. We joined here again in L'Aquila, we met again. So I'm very pleased to welcome Fabio back in L'Aquila and to have him on the stage, and he's going to talk about acidic catalysis and his journey with acid. So, Fabio, you
see yours. I will just share my screen. So welcome everybody, and yeah, we talk enough about the title of the of my presentation, and more or less we have the same idea, and it's meant to be like a dialogue actually, and yeah, and it's called A Journey Through Acid Catalysis, but actually, in every everyday during our life, we can map acid, like ascorbic acid or nucleic acid, or like I don't know, some cosmetic. So why it need to be a journey? Because actually mine was a journey, starting from Terni. Here is the most wonderful monument of my city. Here is the station. And then, okay, we don't have sea, but I like to think about sail, actually, and I don't sail much. And so, and then I move a bit around, and I come back to L'Aquila. So why here I put like this little boat? Because here maybe is the most important piece of knowledge, take home message of my talk, and it's like a poetry that I find marvelous. And it's, I will not read all, I'll just read this part and the end part. And so when you set up your journey to Ithaca, pray that the road is long, full of adventure and full of knowledge. So then the rest you will read better than me at all, basically. And so now back to the reality. Let's see how it is organized, the talk. We have like a small introduction about the concept that we will see and that will help us to get into the talk. So Brosted and Lowry theory, a bit of about the concept of catalysis, chirality, and merging the two of them, asymmetric catalysis. Because in all this kind of like in all my career, I've just done mostly asymmetric catalysis. And then we'll be like, we will see some example of what acid can do, or at least, I mean, what I experienced. So they can form salt in the one that's called asymmetric counter-anion directed catalysis. And they can break substances, like giving like some rearrangement. And they can react with metals, so they can like substitute, in the case that we will see, they can substitute a metal in a molecule, in an asymmetric fashion. So what about the Brosted theory? I will not repeat anymore the other name. So basically it says that when an acid and a base react together, the acid give the proton to the base and form one conjugate base, and the base that then is protonated form one conjugated acid, and like they can form like an ion pair, so just interact to each other during, for example, a catalytic process. We have like we pass from give some hints about catalysis. We have like a reaction profile general, like the black one is not catalyzed, while we see that the red one is catalyzed, and it occurs a much lower energy activation energy. And we can see that every single step of a catalytic reaction is like a reaction itself. But basically, the catalyst stay in contact with the substrates to make them react faster. And at the end, in the product, there's no catalyst. Because the catalyst is free to take another couple of reagents and make again, like in a cycle, basically, the one that is so-called catalytic cycle. Now, what we need from catalysis to asymmetric catalysis, we need the concept that for me is wonderful because it's general, it's not just about chemistry, the concept of chirality. So, yeah. our hands, okay, first the definition, chirality is a geometrical property of an object to do not be superimposable to its mirror image. So basically, I love this this picture actually, so I didn't put like normal hands, like 2D hands, but you can just put your hand on the table and you will see that your hand cannot be like matching like perfectly just by moving on the table basically. So your right hand doesn't match with your left hand in this way basically. And that's called chirality. Once again from Greek language, like the poetry basically. And we can find it also in flower. Okay, the resolution of the image is not really, really good. But you can see that like this this flower that in Italian is called calle. I don't know in English actually. That, like they rotate like in their structure. And this one rotates in this part. And this one rotates in this other direction. So this one counterclockwise and this one clockwise. The same properties, of course, once again, we can encounter it in the DNA. And here maybe it's much clearer to see that this DNA is not superimposable with its mirror image. Of course, this property, we can find it also in molecule. It is just true general molecule. That once again they have the same property, and this two couple of molecules that are identical for everything, but not for the distribution of the atom in the space. They are called like enantiomer, and this will help us to describe this other phenomena. So we have like two enantiomer of the same molecule of a limonene. So we have this enantiomer that smell like lemon, and this other enantiomer that smell like orange. So different enantiomer, they have different biological properties. So that's why it's also important to synthesize preferentially one enantiomer respect to the other one. Oh, here we have like another chiral molecule that we will help us to continue the talk. The next slide. And this also a natural molecule, and we can also find around us this molecule is in tonic water, is the bitter taste of tonic water, and it's called quinine. So how to make then asymmetric catalysis? Before we have seen that a catalyst can basically create a close interaction between himself and the substrate and like activate the reaction at a lower energy. So then what about if we make like we use a chiral catalyst? Then in this case we have asymmetric catalysis. All this intermediate will be chiral with the reagents, and if we are like good or lucky enough, we will end up as well with a chiral product. So that's the first topic, like acid can form salt, and basically we know clearly we can use salt in the kitchen. But the salt that we were talking about, we will talk about today, is like more similar to ammonium acetate. And once again, following the theory of Brønsted and Lowry, we can see that the ammonium acetate is formed from acetic acid plus a base that is ammonia to form like ammonium and acetate. And basically this proton, it ended up here, like we have seen before. So, where we have used this strategy? In this simple reaction that actually is an addition reaction. And we wanted to make asymmetric. We have like this reagent that and this reagent that for new chemical bond here. And we want also to make this bond like chiral. So the molecule is chiral. We want to make this this bond in an enantioselective fashion. So we want to choose which enantiomer we want to synthesize. So we were using this catalytic salt from a derivative of quinine. And since it's basic, I don't know why it's this. It's an acetate. I'm sorry. And this catalytic salt is formed from a quinine and a trifluoroacetic acid anion. Actually, didn't save my correction, my last minute correction. And so with this catalyst, we were having like our product in 82% of the desired enantiomer and 18% of the enantiomer that we didn't want. So, and this two number basically, that is called enantiomeric ratio, so the ratio between the two enantiomer, they can be also described as enantiomeric excess, basically. So, how we solve this problem together with Professor Carlone and the group of Melchiorre, we didn't use anymore an achiral salt, but applying the principle of asymmetric counteranion that direct the catalysis, we use as well a catalytic salt from a chiral counteranion and our chiral catalyst. In this case, we obtain basically almost one enantiomer of the reaction, 96% to 4. And after that, we make other project with this principle, and I finished my PhD. And then I moved to the next island. Ah, okay, sorry. One thing I forgot to tell. Just keep in mind this molecule, because this one was kind of another chiral amine. Actually, it's an amino acid that was really, really good for activating this kind of molecule that we were like trying as well to activate. And actually, our system was better. So I mean, at the end, we managed to publish a good paper. But before, the starting point was from the group of Jorgensen with this other molecule. So after that, I went to visit another island, so-called. It was not in Egypt, it was in Germany. But actually, this time, once in a while, in summer, we were going to Windboat. And when we were not going to Windboat, so the rest of the year, and so just 1 week for summer. And we were basically using acids like crazy, and also for breaking like lab coats, like in this kind of picture, for example. Or in my case, we will see to break hydrazines, basically. Not like it happened when we burned it in the space in the propeller for the space shuttle, like in a controlled way. But basically, we were taking advantage of the high energy that was stored inside the NN bond of the hydrazine. So, and how we were doing it? So we were doing. Wait a second! I forgot to. It's never too late. We were doing it in this reaction, in this asymmetric reaction. This is our hydrazine. And since this compound has two nitrogen, it's basic. and it can be protonated by an acid that breaks actually the hydrazine itself, and then form again this bond. That's why it's called rearrangement. And in this way, since we have again one acid in close proximity, this new bond can be formed in an antiselective way. So this was the chiral acid that we used, a bit more complex. And this was the molecule, basically, that we managed to synthesize in almost pure, basically. So the last part of my... this is important, more or less. Always keep Ithaca in your mind. So we will see how to be like clear in mind can help, like in research, basically. So, or might help in research. We give our best. And so then I moved to University of Göttingen.
Se te la mangi pure tu, sì, se no io la faccio solo con la...
tartufo.
Buon appetito.
Buono il tartufo. Ok, we continue. And then I moved to University of Göttingen, and yeah, I was saying that just this sentence basically means a lot. Means that you have to be like always clear in your mind and keep like your goal, and do not hurry. Basically, I didn't hurry at all. Actually, I'm a really slow person. And in Göttingen, we were making like catalysis with metal, but once in a while, I was also making them react with Brosted acid to solve our problem. So yes, that's the reaction of sodium plus acid. Please don't do it. And this time, I mean, with cobalt was much smoother, the thing. Actually, even too much smoother. Too smooth. So basically, when I arrived, they just published this reaction with this complex, just cobalt, this metal, and this reactant to form this other compound. I mean, it's still a reaction where it's an addition reaction. Sorry, guys. Or maybe I can drink a bit. Anyway, we almost finished. Where it's form a chiral center, but since they were using this acid that was not chiral, basically was the molecule was not chiral. And I arrived and they told me, just make this reaction and antiselective. You work with acid, so. So it was really difficult, actually, because the acid, this is another catalytic cycle that is not really, really interesting, actually. And for the take-home message of the talk. So here we have our metal that make all the reaction without the acid, and the acid just arrived here at the end. And then he has to make like the reaction an antioselective. So he has basically to choose one of the two enantiomer of this intermediate and protonate just one of them. And the other one will go back to form this intermediate without the bond, and then it can go again. And once again the acid can protonate, S2 protonate, just one of the two enantiomer of the reaction. So yeah, I was getting a bit crazy to synthesize and test a lot of acid. Then basically I remember my previous study, actually speaking with Professor Ackermann, and we remember about this molecule, and then we say, okay, this is not acid, it's like kind of a non-natural amino acid, but what about if we just protect this to nitrogen, and maybe it might be good for our reaction. And yeah, at a certain point you just need to be a bit lucky. And actually this also this reaction was good, was in high in antiemetic excess, and yeah, and so we managed to publish this, and basically this maybe helped me a lot to be hired in L'Aquila University. So finishing, I don't like summary at the end of talk because you should maybe. Of course, you were really interested on what I was saying, so you don't need any summary. And I want just to spend this few minutes for thanking Melchiorre Group at University of Bologna, Liz Group at Max Planck Institute for Colin Fortune in Mülheim, Ackermann Group at University of Göttingen, and Carlone Group at University of L'Aquila. And actually, I was promising that I want to say that Ithaca give me like at the end. I mean, I come back to Terni. I don't like much the my city. It's not that wonderful. Everything from the first picture. But the thing that was really funny on this was basically the journey, and without basically the aiming to come back to my city, maybe I would have never started the journey itself. And so, yeah, and finally, I want to thank Royal Society of Chemistry because they give me some money to test acid for the activation of CO2. So we will see basically how my experience with acid will continue. And with this, I hope that I interested you. And I'm sorry because actually I keep drinking, but my throat is really dry, and it's finished.
Hello, Fabio. Thank you very much.
Just hello.
I'm going to remove my background because now it's been overused. Anyway, like, thanks a lot. So actually, it's a very interesting talk, I must say, and it's actually a very interesting group meeting as well. I think I've been at different group meetings around the world, and I need to admit the only group meeting where I had people having lunch during the group meeting was in the Netherlands. But at least they had lunch already. They weren't choosing the menu. So guys, I hope that it's nice to be listening to people, that they spend their time in preparing the talk for you rather than choosing the menu. Anyway, let's go ahead with the questions. While we collect questions in the chat, Mark is probably collecting them. I just wanted to say that, you know, during one of our outreach events, when we were doing molecular cocktails in the center of L'Aquila, we actually even showed that gin tonic is UV reactive. So we were actually showing that the quinine in the tonic water was actually UV visible. So, you know, they were doing like molecular cocktails and we're actually showing how quinine reacted. Anyway, let's go to the question. And so if Michaela was asking, are there any criteria for choosing to synthesize one enantiomer compared to another? For example, in your study.
So, how this thing work? The first reaction, basically you don't know, unless you know basically if the catalyst is known, you already know basically. You know a lot of background, a lot of mechanistic study on the reaction. So basically you know which enantiomer you expect, but you need to confirm it if the reaction is not fully reported in literature. And for novel projects like the three that I present to you, they were novel at a different time, but they were all novel. And yeah, we didn't know which enantiomer we expected. But of course, if with an enantiomer of the catalyst, I synthesize one enantiomer of the product, with the opposite enantiomer of the catalyst, I will synthesize the opposite enantiomer of the product. This is 100% sure. It was clear?
If I may add a point, Michaela says she. I don't know. I mean, I guess Michaela probably knows more than me about it. Like she's more in the field than me. But when we prepare drugs, so drugs are very often, not always, but very often chiral molecules because they interact with our body. And whereas one enantiomer of a drug can be beneficial to us, the other enantiomer could have no effects at all, but otherwise could be, even be like a poisonous to our body. So when a pharmaceutical company synthesizes a drug, they need to test both of the enantiomers of the drug. So even if they know that one enantiomer is good, is beneficial for the treatment of a disease, they still need to test the other one to show the impact of the other one. So yes, I mean, synthesizing the enantiomers is very important, and even knowing which one is being synthesized is even more crucial for drugs. I'm sure I was just talking to people who are not familiar with this, whereas I think Michaela is working in that field. So Marco is asking, are there ways to purify one synthesized enantiomer versus the one you don't care about?
I will not put again the presentation, but basically you've seen that we use like catalysts and we put catalysts for synthesize the one enantiomer or the other of the reaction. So what the technology build it up like method of purification, like a chromatographic column, HPLC column, and where the stationary phase basically is made of a chiral molecule in an enantiopure form. So basically the enantiomer, the mixture that maybe is like 50-50 of the two enantiomer, will start to go down to the column, but one will interact better with the chiral enantiopure stationary phase and then will stay longer, and the other one will just go faster, and then you separate with the chromatographic techniques with the chiral enantiopure stationary phase. Or this is like, you can basically form, like again with acid, if you use like a chiral acid and you want to resolve like a base, or if you want to resolve a base, you use you want to resolve an acid, you use a chiral base. Anyway, so you can form a salt with your molecule to resolve and a molecule that is an enantiopure. And then these two salts will have like, it's called just stereoisomeric salt. It's basically will have different properties, because the, like, if I use a chiral acid to resolve a mixture 50-50 of a base, the acid will have like different interaction once again and different chemical properties if it react with the one enantiomer of the base respect to the other one. I hope that this, there is some method based on this, basically. You use something enantiopure to resolve something that is not enantiopure. And asymmetric catalysis is better, because you just use a small amount of chiral enantiopure molecule to synthesize directly, like at the end of the reaction, your chiral compound. I hope that I was clear in sponsoring enough my field of research.
Well, even more than beside your field, also you had the course you're teaching. I think like Marco was still requested for 33, it's actually probably a quarter of the course you teach, like organic synthesis. So if someone wants to follow, Marco is also following up from his question, asking, is there any way to do that in flow rather than in batch, like you would do with column?
In flow. Yeah, with the chromatographic column. So the HPLC, they just don't work in flow, but I guess that is just because of the purpose of the HPLC. I guess that a chiral column can be used in maybe multiple injection, actually, maybe not in in flow, but for sure somebody has thought about that, actually.
I've been doing what you call preferential crystallization. It's kind of preferential crystallization where you actually keep crystallizing one enantiomer over the number, and then you do it in flow. It's an industrial process, actually. Otherwise, you cannot. What's applied in industry is called simulating moving bed. So that's actually kind of an HPLC column in flow, but it's, you know, a huge plant that you, it's pretty expensive. But yeah, it, so if you want to Google Marco, it's simulating moving bed, and I'm gonna write in the chat how it's called. It's gonna take probably something like a couple of hours to explain how it works, because it's pretty like complicated, but it's a very interesting piece of equipment for industry. Well, and again, a tricky question to answer in a couple of minutes for people. So, that's an interesting one from Luca. So, thank you very much, Luca. So, Luca, Jackie is asking, you said hydrazine as an nitrogen-nitrogen bond with high energy. Can we use that bond to produce electric energy differently compared to the method that we use now?
Wow. So, in my opinion, so in this catalytic cycle, actually, there is in just this reaction. This reaction, the intermediate like is like is postulate this diradical cation. So basically, it forms like single electron species, and then maybe we can just remove this electron to make the electricity flow. But I don't know. Basically, I'm an organic chemist, so I can see about that. I can see as much as you see in my talk. Basically, you see like the diradical cation intermediate, and I'm happy that maybe I sparking you some idea, but we are just we are equal on that, basically. Maybe you know better than me. And the question that I will ask to you is like why? Basically, that's the hydrazine is not really like a compound that is like is safe, is like hazardous for health, and is highly reactive. So, in principle, the concept is great, but has to be driven towards other radical system, in my opinion.
So, if I understood your answer, the question is basically the answer is. The question is very interesting and it's nice, but the problem is the hydrazine is too unstable to store it as you would do with other source of energy.
Yeah.
So we already have the problem of storing hydrogen. That's why we cannot.
Hydrogen also is highly carcinogenic and it's explosive. I mean, and so on. That's okay, of course. I was not meaning to use it as a fuel vector, because anyway then you have to burn it. So that's the thing. So better to burn hydrogen. That actually is the other component of the no it's not oxygen actually. Oxygen and hydrogen is the fuel of rockets.
With the chat, I think Luca was actually like trying to do a different point of view on the question, but. I like the way I don't know if Luca is a student or a PhD candidate. He's a student, so I like when the student think that way. They tend to connect different dots.
No,
okay, yeah. He's in the Marcos lab, so that okay. I don't like him anymore now. Sorry, Luca. No, per niente. Any more questions, guys? So, I think so. No questions from YouTube. That's what Marco said. So while we, before we wrap up, I just had a kind of like a philosophical question for Fabio. So, you know, you took us through your journey, that you had a journey with acid again. But I mean, I think that's a question more like, you know, for like for students or people who are actually starting to approach their PhD or in the middle of their PhD or thinking about postdoc. You know, anyway, like people that are thinking about their career. Did you plan your career? Did you think about, okay, no, I want to do this, a bit of that, or I want to do research with acids, or did it just happen by chance?
So the first step, actually, that then became true, I dreamt about it first, no? Because to go to work with Liszt was like, was great. And yeah, after I did my interview with him, it was so nice. And I said, okay, I've done it. Even if it doesn't get me, it's fine. I don't care. I've done it. Then it happened that, he likes me. But no, I didn't plan in principle. I'm not the person, actually, I should not say. I don't plan much about my life. And I didn't plan. You cannot plan about that. You cannot plan. Because it happened like this, no? You have to keep the passion high. That's the thing. But so, for example, Benjamin Liszt could have told me, no, there is another person that is slightly better than you, or way better than you. And then what to do? I mean, so the first step after my PhD was wrong, and then what to do? So, and you have just to keep to your mood up, basically. And yeah, let's say more or less it worked. I mean, it worked, but didn't work because of an extremely perfect plan. But it worked because more of the passion, in my case. I mean, then there are people that they plan everything and they succeed. I mean, chapeau to them. But in my case, I mean, the thing that put wind on my sails was the passion. And there was not always good wind, actually.
I think, like as Professor Ted is saying in the chat, it's actually most of the times you are inspired by a mentor. And I agree with that. I mean, I think most of the time the mentor is very important for the people, for anyone of us. Could be like either both in life and in academia, research. So you need to carefully choose your mentor, to be a person with whom you may agree or disagree, but someone who is actually can be an inspiration to you. And well, we're very lucky that around here there are a lot of people. And so, not sure if we are going to wrap up, or is there any other question? Thank you very much, Professor Terry. I don't know if you're reading that, Fabio. Like,
no, I cannot read it.
Okay, I read it for everyone. So what Professor Terry is saying is that she presented the career development guideline for students, and actually it's, again, people can catch up with that on YouTube, on the channel. And what Fabio is saying is actually it's confirming exactly what she said, especially regarding passion. I think I'm following up from that career development guidelines, and I think that was very useful for people, for students to know how to approach your career. We also had a 2-day webinar where we had how to build, how to write your CV, your cover letter, and have an interview with companies. And we had also some guests from companies, like from HR, who told a lot. So, yeah. Good points. I think we're about to wrap up our day, shall I give the mic to Marco again?
Yes, for just 1 second. First of all, thank you both. It was a very nice event. Thank you, Fabio, for your presentation and for the sharing.
Come here.
I just wanted to announce the next event. The next event is going to be one from a very famous person, who is Steve Brusatte. He's a writer in the field of paleontology. He's done a lot of TV shows. He's a very cool guy, and he's a professor in Edinburgh. So next week we will have him, and don't miss that. He's going to talk about how the dinosaurs went extinct. So we have a big change of topic. We like to do that in the TMS, and Professor Teddy would be the chair for the event. So don't miss it. It's going to be next week. It's not going to be at the same time. It's going to be at 2, so half an hour later than usual. And there is also going to be another slight change. It's not going to be held via Teams, but via WebEx, Cisco WebEx, which is simpler for you because you just have to click on a link. We will remind you this on the email, of course. But okay, so thank you the attendees and Armando and Fabio, and see you next time.
Welcome.
Bye bye everyone. Have a good day.
Bye bye.